Hello YouTube. This is not going to be a short video, but the subject is very important. It has to do with Ivan Yefremov, and you can find out more about this enigmatic scientist and writer from the Soviet Union. You can find it in my playlist. He was considered to be an extraterrestrial spy by the KGB, and the files pertaining to his case are still locked up in Russia. There's no more Soviet Union, but the files that were opened up by the KGB of the Soviet Union are still concealed. I don't know if we'll ever see them accessible to the public. So let me tell you why I made this video. In 1972, Ivan Yefremov published his novel Thais of Athens. You can, and in my opinion, you should read the novel. It's now available in English and I believe in Spanish and a few other languages. Historical Thais or Thais supposedly came from Athens and accompanied Alexander the Great throughout his campaigns in Asia. The narrative of the book, of the novel, takes place in the 4th century BC during the campaigns of Alexander the Great and covers various places from the Peloponnese to Mesopotamia, from Athens to Memphis in Egypt. It presents a peculiar set of philosophy, history, art, religion, rituals, life, and customs in the era of Alexander. And it was during the clash of the ancient Greece or Hellas and Asia, and much more. It reveals some of what the strange Russian, if that was he was, genius Yefremov, knew about what we can call as lost, forbidden, or just basically unknown to most ancient history and knowledge. Let's look at some of the interesting things the author discussed. I think those who follow such research will find this information very interesting, and maybe it will show you how my interest came about. I try always to tell a little bit about my research and the decades I spent actually pursuing what Yefremov started to the best of my abilities. Look, the revelations in that book come from the ancient wise men of India, China, and more. The protagonist, beautiful Hetaira Thais, met them at different stages of her life, whether in Egypt, Europe, or Asia. Sometimes she was accompanied by her philosopher friends or her sculptor friend, also Greek. And some of the places she had encounters at were temples of different religions. Wait till you read what those temples were and what was happening inside or under the temples. Yefremov described the ancient Greek philosopher Anaxagoras. He was the first Hellenian to teach that the sun was a fiery globe. And Anaximander, he was teaching that man is a result of a long line of transformations of animals, starting with a primordial fish-like creature. He also realized the vastness of space and inhabited worlds. And there was Alcmaeon, the physician and student of Pythagoras, who discovered 2 centuries before Thais lived that the brain was the organ of intelligence and the receptor of the senses. He also discovered that planets followed circular orbits. He was also ridiculed, but the Orphic teaching, Indian, meaning ancient Indian, from India in spirit, was either taken from ancient Indians or from their common ancestors with the Greeks. Here is more of what the wise men of India revealed during their encounter with Thais in an ancient temple in Babylon. Shakti, the power of nature, or Mahamaya, the great illusion, indicated that the primal forces must correspond to the six, to the number six, and stand in the following sequence. 1. Parashakti, the higher power of warmth and light that gives life to all things on earth. 2. Janani Shakti, the power of the mind and wise knowledge. It is two-sided. The first is Smriti, or memory. This is a huge power capable of bringing ancient notions and future expectations to life. The other side is foresight, the ability to see through the curtain of Maya into time, which is one of in all three of its aspects, past, present, and future, and is much more complex than the time past with the beating of one's heart. 3. Iksha Shakti, the willpower, the currents flowing through the body and concentrated on the fulfillment of desires. 4. Kriya Shakti, or the power of thought, which is material and can have physical impact with its energy. 5. Kundalini Shakti, the life principle of all nature. This power undulates like a snake and combines two great contradictions of attraction and repulsion, which is why it is also called a serpent. Kundalini balances out the inner and outer aspects of life. Its forward movement inside a person gives him or her the power of Kama Eros and leads to transformation. 6. Matrika Shakti, the power of speech, music, signs, and letters. The Indian wise man also said that their sacred book, Aitareia, calls the Greek Gaia, Earth, Sarporagini, or Queen of Serpents, the mother of all moving things. For a serpent is a symbol of movement in the struggle between opposing forces. According to their myths, there used to be a race of snake-like people, or nags, who numbered no more than 1,000. The people who inhabited the earth now are the fifth race, created under the symbol of bull and cow. The bull is sacred in the Greek land in the west, and the cow is sacred in India. From the Naga, I think that's the better pronunciation, their people have inherited the ability to rule over the poisonous snakes of India. Much in the Indian stories remained unclear to Thais and her friend Lysippus. The enormous extent of time tracked by them from the creation of the world went entirely against the calculations of the Egyptian, Phoenician, Hebrew, and Pythagorean scholars. The Hebrews had the shortest count of only 6,000 years. Now, according to the Indian data, the first real people appeared on earth 18,616,516 years ago. That's, we're looking at the times of Alexander the Great, okay? With the same frightening precision, the Indians had calculated the length of the dark and menacing period of troubles in the history of mankind, which started after the great battle in India 2,770 years prior. The era, as they called it, Kali Yuga, was to last another 429,000 years. Other scholars believe it to be much shorter, the Indian wise man added when he was speaking to the Greeks, only a bit over 5,000 years. Such enormous discrepancy contradicted the precision of the enormous numbers. Noting the Hellenians' confusion, the Indians continue to tell them about the precise calculations developed by their mathematicians. In the Book of Solar Science, the time was segmented in a way which the Hellenians were not familiar. 1 hour equal 24 Hellenian minutes, or ancient Greek, and 1 minute, or vakala, was 24 seconds. The time was further fragmented by a factor of 60, all the way down to a kashta, an unimaginably brief moment of 1/300 millionth of a second. to the Lysippus question, what was the use in numbers that could be neither measured or imagined? The Indian replied that the human mind had two stages of consciousness. At the higher stage, called buddhi, a person was capable of comprehending such small measures and understanding the structure of the world made up of the smallest particles and central forces that were eternal and undefeatable strong, despite their being mere points of energy. Also, the wise men of India told the Greeks about the great physician Jivak, who lived 300 years before and possessed a stone that could show a body's internal organs. They also learned of another healer who protected people from smallpox by making a small scratch and rubbing into it some blood from a person who had survived the disease. Later, Lysippus rose up and left the Athenian Thais alone with the Indian wise man and went to his room. He returned with a large chest made of purple amaranth wood with ornate golden corners. Having placed it carefully on the octagonal table, the sculptor opened the clasp. He revealed a strange mechanism, a combination of gears and levers of various sizes. Silver rings were marked with letters and symbols. The Indians leaned over the chest, obviously interested. A follower of Pythagoreans, Heraclitus of Pont, who was close to Aristotle, discovered that the globe of Gaia revolves around itself, akin to a top, and that its axis is tipped with respect to the plane traveled by the sun and its planets. This mechanism was built to calculate the movement of planets, without which navigation and prediction of the future could not exist. Here is someone's mind that established itself one time, having designed this mechanism to be followed by the others' hands and the tables inscribed on the cover. People who use it are free from long calculations and have time for higher pursuits. Okay, here's what the wise man of India told Thais when she questioned their policy of limiting the access to their knowledge. That is because there are so few of you, and you are forced to preserve your students in order to ensure the passage of the torch of knowledge. But there are so many of us. If we shout out our knowledge in a town square, it will be instantly distorted by the ignorant and turn against true scholars. In Kriya Shakti and Kundalini, we have discovered secrets of personal strength, and we carefully guard the technique of its learning and usage. It would cause great trouble if this knowledge were to end up with a person of in-person karma. This is when Thais discovered the law of karma or retribution. Karma made Nemesis, daughter of the night, and the Hellenian or Greek goddess of fair punishment, look naive, small, and weak. In the colossal cosmic mechanism, whose workings were at the basis of the world, all things, gods, people, and animals, were subject to karma. They must all live out their errors, imperfections, and particularly their crimes in a series of incarnations, their fate growing better or worse depending on their personal and social behavior. Lying and deceit, especially captured in books, constituted terrible crimes because they resulted in harmful consequences for many people and could take thousands of years to eliminate. Destruction of beauty was also considered to be one of the worst crimes. When someone forbade something to someone else, he took upon himself the karma of his subject, whatever it might be. Those who wish to rule build traps for gullible people and for the rest of us, because we earn for miracles and all things unusual. Those who want to control people's minds construct traps by playing numbers, symbols and formulas, spheres and sounds, giving them semblance to the keys of knowledge. Those who wish to control emotions the way tyrants and politicians do, especially emotions of the mob, they build enormous palaces that humble people and take over their emotions. A man who wanders into such a trap loses his individuality and dignity. The teaching sprang from the depth of past centuries of the combined wisdom of Crete, they refer to Minoan Crete, and India, uniting the belief in reincarnation with the rejection of the hopelessness of the circles of light and fate. The great principle, all things flow, change, and pass, ran into a question: would there be a return to the past? Yes, there always will be, the scholars of Syria and Pythagoras stated, the latter being the most famous student of the Orphic. No, there will not be, the philosophers of the old Orphic type disagreed. It is not the wheel that constantly makes one circle after another, but a spiral. This is the true flow of changing things, and this is our salvation from the wheel. Gods did not create the universe, the Orphics were teaching. It came to be from the natural physical powers of the world. Cosmos is order. First and foremost, the egg of the universe formed from chaos, chronos, time, and ether, space. The egg started growing until one half of it formed the sky and the other one formed the earth. Between them, bios, life, was born. Satisfying the needs of thinkers in their own era, the Orphic could not have suspected, of course, that 26 centuries later, the greatest minds of the hugely increased mankind would accept a similar concept of the origins of cosmos, with the exception of excluding Earth from the dominance over the universe. That's what Yefremov added. Along with the teachings of reincarnation from Asia, the Orphic preserved ancient local rituals. From you, the Delos philosopher said, the Orphic teaching requires us to remember that a man's spiritual future is in his hands and not entirely dependent on gods and fate, as everyone from Egypt to Carthage believes. One cannot compromise along this path. And here's what else the wise men of India revealed. Even with all of your wisdom, you may not know of a legend that there was once a land in the west which was wiped out by terrible earthquakes and underwater volcano eruptions. I know this legend, and she does too, Lysippus said, pointing to Thais. And so do those of my students who have read Critias and Timaeus by Plato. There once was a rich and powerful seafaring country in the west. Its capital, the City of Waters, perished from the wrath of Poseidon and Gaia. Egyptian priests, from whom Plato learned this legend, did not give the precise location of that country, which was called Atlantis. Followers of Plato believe Atlantis to have been located to the west of the Pillars of Hercules in the Great Ocean. Critias, unfortunately, remained unfinished, and we do not know what else the great scholar might have wanted to tell us. The Indians continued, then you know the rest. Our legend states that the seafaring country was in your sea. Its position, description, and time coincide with those of the island of Crete. The time of the demise not of the country itself, but of its wisdom and the best of its people, took place 11 centuries ago, right at the time of the fall of the Cretan state, after the terrible eruption and flood. Lysippus said, addressing Thais, some of the most skillful and knowledgeable people of Crete survived the disaster and subsequent capture by people who attacked Crete the moment its might was crushed and its fleet was gone. They escaped to the east, to their new motherland of Lycaonia and Cilicia, as well as Phrygia. But they found the places for possible settlements were already occupied, so they continued their journey. The legend says nothing of how they could have reached the river Indus, where they founded their city. They found people there who were distantly related to them, the Dravidians, and taught them arts. Whether they traveled across the land to Parthia, Bactria, and the mountains, or whether they managed to sail down the Euphrates and make it into the delta of the Indus from the sea using their seafaring skills, the legend doesn't say. And here is what else Thais and her friends learned. Aristotle turned out to be blind and deaf not only toward the ancient wisdom of Asia, but also to the Hellenians' own science. Although this often happens when one becomes admired and successful on his path, he forgets that he is but a student following one of many roads of discovery. He forgets the necessity of keeping his eyes open, preserving the ancient knowledge in his memory, and combining it with the new. What did he forget, for example? Democritus and Anaximander of Milet, the Pythagoreans and Plato, who taught in agreement with our Orphic legends that Earth is a hemisphere or even a sphere. That is why all maps of flat Earth calculated by Hecates are incorrect. Eudox of Cnid, who lived in Egypt, calculated the size of the Gaia globe by observing the star Canopus and discovered it to be 330,000 stadiums in circumference. This wise man wrote that this distance to the stars is incomprehensibly large for a human mind, and that there are dark stars as well as other inhabited lands like our Gaia. In addition to the planets we already know about, there are many distant ones, and we cannot see them with naked eye, just as not everyone sees the sickle of the planet of mourning dedicated to your goddess. How could Democritus know about the planets invisible to him? I think from the teachers who possessed the knowledge of the ancient people. And at one Babylonian temple, I was shown a small tower with a copper dome that could rotate on a thick axle. The dome was inset with a window made of convex glass of splendidly polished transparent mountain crystal. This round window, 3 pods in diameter, had been called the Eye of the World by the Chaldeans since the ancient times. Through it, the priest managed to see 4 tiny stars in the night sky near the biggest planet. They also saw a greenish planet beyond the gloomy Kronos. I saw it too. Aristotle should know, Lysippus said more gently, that several centuries ago the Phoenicians followed the order of the pharaoh Necho and sailed around the shores of Libya. Having spent 2 years on this heroic undertaking, they proved that Libya is an island of the size surpassing all imagination. They didn't find the edge of the world, nor did they find gods or spirits, but the sun started doing strange things in the sky. It rose straight above their heads at noon, but then tilted to the side, although the sailors were still headed south. Then the sun started rising on their right instead of their left. It means that first they went around Libya and turned north while following its shores. The change of the noonday location of the sun toward the south or north during their voyage speaks of that, which has long since been known to the Orphic and priests of India and Babylon, who used a wheel as the symbol of the world. But Earth looks like a wheel on the maps of Hecatus II, a flat wheel. The Orphic know that this wheel is in fact a sphere, and the Indians have long since considered Earth to be a globe. Later, Thais met with a guest from the distant east, a yellow-skinned man with eyes that were even more narrow and slanted than those of the dwellers of Central Asia. The features of his face were delicate and looked somewhat like a mask carved out of pear wood. The traveler assured them that it had been 8 years since he had left his native country. He had crossed monstrous expanses of mountains, valleys, deserts, and forests, all inhabited by different people. According to his calculations, he had walked, ridden, and sailed a distance 3 times greater than that covered by Alexander when he voyaged from Ecbatana to Alexandria Exhata. He told Thais the following: "My heavenly empire, or middle empire as we call it, lies 20,000 stadiums to the east of the River of Sands, using your measure. His people discovered many things she would have considered a fairy tale in her home country. The yellow-faced traveler taught her that the heavenly empire was born during times as ancient as those of the origins of Egypt, Crete, and Mesopotamia. He spoke of a precise calendar created 2,000 years before the construction of the Parthenon. According to him, the state had been founded 2,000 years prior to the establishment of that calendar. He spoke of the skilled craftsmen and artists, of astronomers who made maps of the sky, and of mechanics who created complex water-powered devices. He told her of unusually tall bridges, temple towers of iron, china, and bronze, of palaces erected atop man-made hills, and artificial lakes dug by thousands of slaves. The wise men of the heavenly empire had even created a device which could predict earthquakes and where the earthquakes were to take place. The traveler described in detail places where nature had been made more beautiful by human hands, like the mountains crowned by temples, whose wide staircases of thousands of steps were surrounded by ancient trees. He spoke of roads made of blue glazed bricks, which led to sacred places, and alleys of tall, wide barked pines, every tree the identical height and age, stretching for hundreds of stadiums. The son of the heavenly empire spoke of skilled doctors who healed patients by sticking tiny gold needles into affected areas. He amazed the Greeks with his story of two glass and metal mirrors at the emperor's palace, which could help a doctor see through a person and find places impacted by illness inside the body." This is what Ivan Yefremov described in his wonderful book, Thais of Athens. Trust me, I told you some of the information. I don't want to spoil your amazement of reading the books and things from antiquity that you cannot learn in college, of course, and I don't think most archaeologists in the West realize, but it took the mental power, the genius of Yefremov to put it all together, and he did it, I think, on purpose, because he wanted to show us something very interesting. You should find out more what happened to him and what happened after he died and so forth in my videos. But now I want to tell you something interesting, because that's not the only book of his, of course, that I've analyzed and used as a guide to me. In 1996, I published a long article titled Egyptian Secrets of Mexico, in Russian, of course. It appeared in several Russian publications. I analyzed Yefremov's books for my research of somewhat strange discoveries in Mexico. I will not go into Mexico, and maybe someday I will translate that article into English, but I will limit myself to right now to one Yefremov. So let's look at the Bauer Jet's journey. The story begins during the reign of pharaohs Chedefra of the 4th dynasty of the ancient kingdom of Egypt. It was like 2566 to 2558 BC. The young pharaoh Chedefra wants to continue the glory of his predecessor, the great pharaoh Djoser, and correct the consequences of the disasters that claimed thousands of lives of Egyptians during the construction of the huge pyramid of Cheops. No one except the mighty people, gods of antiquity, reached the limits of Pont, or Punt, wrote Ivan Antonovich Yefremov, remarkable Soviet scientist and writer, in his book or novel, The Journey of Bauer Jet. Bauer Jet's seven-year voyage to the semi-legendary Punt country, and Yefremov believed that it was located on the coast of the Gulf of Aden, the location of the mysterious Punt country. Well, it has not been precisely determined. Some researchers believe that it could be located on the west coast of India, others on the African coast, south of the Red Sea, where Somalia is now located, and even further south to the banks of the Zambezi River. Well, it ended unsuccessfully. It turned out that the limit of the Earth is still infinitely far. And there beyond the Earth flows a great arc, the ocean, the limits of which are unknown to anyone. And I'm just citing now from the book. But was there an ingrained notion that the whole Earth is limited to the country of Egypt? After all, the testament of Pharaoh Djoser, translated into Russian to his descendants, says that the world is great and inhabited by many people or peoples. Neter had Djoser speaks for his descendants, commanding them to remember this in the difficult hour of the black earth, meaning Egypt, or black land. It is possible to turn the forces of the Cam Egypt to conquer countries, and their peoples then will give up their riches. Pharaoh Djoser died 100 years before the events that Yefremov told us about. The expedition of Bauer Jet was sent on a long journey by Pharaoh Djedefra of the 4th dynasty of the ancient kingdom. Well, the late Soviet Egyptologist Katznelson wrote that the era of the ancient kingdom of Ta Kem, that's how Egypt was called, about 2880 to about 2270 BC, that it covers the reign of the 3rd and 4th dynasties. It began with the accession of Djoser, during which his supreme advisor, the dignitary Imhotep, a brilliant architect, healer, and sage, later deified. That's when he erected the first step pyramid in Saqqara, that's near modern Cairo. While the voyage lasted, the treacherous Khafra, Djedefra's brother, killed his brother and became the pharaoh. The country's forces were directed to the construction of a new great pyramid, a symbol of the country's closeness to itself, encapsulation. Bauer Jet's story provoked a reproach from the new pharaoh. The treasurer returned with little loot, very little acquired things, lost many slaves and skilled warriors, and did nothing to magnify the name of the kings of camped in distant countries. The arrogant narcissism of the Lord provoked indignation from the treasurer, who had just experienced all the greatness of the wide world. The longing for freedom and the spaciousness of the years spent on the journey will no longer allow our jet to live as before. Let me cite you something else. The paths on earth are hard. Only the great ark, submitting to brave hearts, carries people over vast distances and connects them together. In the conquest of the great ark, the future happiness of the land of camp, in the knowledge of the vastness of the world, its wisdom, in a good and a numerous fleet, this is where the strength is. Build ships capable of fighting the sea, as revealed to me by the wisdom of Imhotep. Strengthen your heart and follow this true path. This is an authentic ancient Egyptian inscription translated by the Russian academician Turayev. And Imhotep, as we know, was a court scholar and advisor to Pharaoh Djoser, who was an outstanding king of the Third Dynasty. At the great house, this is how the ancient Egyptians called their king, Per-O, from where it became Pharaoh. Well, there were enormous economic difficulties in the Black Land, Egypt, at that time, because the river did not rise for 7 years and the country was in the greatest need. The wise Imhotep, a fruitful scientist and statesman, having received the question posed by Djoser, knew where to look for answers. He went to the deity, to the god, as he called it. He went to the sanctuary of the deity Thoth, popularly known as the Nosy. He was depicted with the head of an ibis, to inquire in the souls of Ra. Went and soon he returned and told me about the raising of the river and all the things related to it. He revealed to me miracles to which no one of the kings of the beginning had yet been shown the way. Ta Kem, the black earth, colloquially Kem or Kem means black. Again, this is what the Egyptians called their country. So, who did the Imhotep go to for advice? Let us, my audience, try to answer another question. Did the ancients Rome, or another name for the Egyptians, cross the Great Ark? We know that they knew the Green Sea, the Mediterranean, and the Azure waters, the Red Sea. We know that the Egyptian sailors were looking for the Punt, the legendary country rich in gold and incense. We don't know that. But what to me is more interesting is, what were these people gods of antiquity that Yefremov mentions in his historical novel? In preparation for writing this novel, he was very dedicated. He assiduously or thoroughly studied the material. Are his diaries, notes, notebooks left somewhere where we have no way to access? Yefremov's appeal to the historical topic was prepared by his professional interest in the distant past of the earth, to the origins of the human civilization. I think he knew much more about the travels of the ancient Egyptians than was told to us in the wonderful novel that was published in a very stormy year in the Soviet history, the year of 1953. So, did Imhotep turn to the people gods for advice? This is what appears from the historical records that Yefremov brought forward. Somewhere in his archives, there has to be more information. Look, in Arabic legends, by the way, the Pharaoh appears as the embodiment of brute force and injustice, and his retinue consists of giants. When Imhotep went to the repository of the shrines of Thoth, the god of wisdom, he inquired there in the souls of Ra. That is, he asked someone or something a question, like we ask computers, for example, like we look into the computer information for answers. He asked about the homeland of Hapi, that's about the origins of the Nile. And he, I can call him a scientist, because I think that's what he was. He received an accurate and detailed answer. And what is it, that entity, the souls of Ra? The original text translated into Russian by academician Turaev reads like this: the 11th of the 42 great and secret books called Souls of Ra contains a list of all localities and the doctrine of what they contain. The scribe is the one himself. So is it like the ancient computer software containing geographical data? Look, I do not want to expand this narrative too much to the borders of the Celestial Empire, for example, or China. But I have some information about the computers of ancient China. Now, the souls of Ra, what kind of information was recorded in them about the country known to us as Mexico, for example? Giants are the Kiname of the Aztecs. Aren't they mighty people gods of the ancient Egyptians? And why are snakes always guardians? Guardians on the forehead of the great house of Egypt, okay? Or the pharaoh. At the entrance to the, and also to the ancient sanctuaries of the Indians, connecting the earth with the sky. In ancient Sumer, such ties between our planet and the sky were known. The chronicles of Sumer called them Dur-An-Ki, heaven-earth bond. One of the sons of the god Anu, Enlil, built his headquarters, the city of Nippur, where the bonds were located. Humanity had not yet been created in the laboratories of the Nephilim or Anunnaki, according to some interpretations of that ancient history. The ancient annals of Sumer stated that the Anunnaki were ordinary deities, that they took part in the colonization of the earth, deities who performed tasks. Enlil commanded them. The goddess or deity Ninhursag was the first of the Anunnaki to set foot on earth. In Egypt, apparently she was known as Hathor. The ancient chronicles quite clearly define her profession. The goddess was the chief biologist and doctor of the expedition. It was she who helped Enki, her brother, to conduct experiments on the creations of the Homo sapiens through genetics. Ninhursag temple in the city of Kesh was decorated with the image of a huge poisonous snake. Let's remember the symbol of medicine, and let's remember the wall of snakes. Now, the chronicles say that 300 Anunnaki of heaven, or I believe they were called Gaga, were genuine astronauts in the sense that they did not visit our planet but remained on board of their spaceships. And the spacecraft was in near-Earth orbit, receiving and sending reusable air and space vehicles, shuttles to Earth. So I know that Yefremov, based on his books, knew very much about ancient Sumer and Babylonian Mesopotamia, and he pointed out, which I always do also, great civilizations of the past: Minoan Crete, ancient Egypt, India, of course, China, and we have the civilizations of South America. There had to be a connection. I think he knew it. It was very interesting, and I revealed it in my other research and videos. Yefremov had very interesting ties with Chinese scientists, I think, who were studying the same thing. We just don't know the extent of it. And really, knowledge that they exchanged. And Yefremov, in his expeditions, he was a so-called dinosaur hunter. And you should, again, look at my videos. Look what he did in Mongolia. And the discovery of this strange burial with a giant being inside. This is incredible. This has to be investigated. But I don't know how it can be done. And who would do it. Anyway, I want to tell you this. In Yefremov's cosmogony, or the view of the universe, man is the only rational being in the universe. Any other thinking beings or sentient beings should not differ from human being, from man. Man embodies life and the anti-entropy of the world, opposes evil, suffering, and death. Only man can stop the endless game of blind elemental forces and can defeat stagnant inanimate matter. To the unification of mankind, the spread of reason, ethical space exploration, expedient and comprehensive reconstruction of the world, victory over time and space. Do you know that Yefremov, in the Soviet Union of the 1940s and 1950s, he was writing about ecology and the damage that was being done to our planet when really no one was thinking or talking about that. You have to read his books. You will find incredible information there, including, even the planet of Pluto. Look at my videos about what he knew about the Pluto, what we're going to find there. And the great circle of the universe where sentient beings were exchanging information throughout our galaxy and how it was done. Incredible. And you will start seeing things when we see happening today. Listen again. Unification of mankind, the spread of reason, ethical space exploration compared to what's going on today, expedient and comprehensive reconstruction of the world. This is smart. Not destroying the world, but reconstructing the planet to bring the best that nature has given to us. Victory over time and space. Isn't that what's being done today by a number of oligarchs and rich people who want to defeat the death itself? There are no semitones in Yefremov's universe. There is an eternal struggle between the forces of life and death, energy and entropy, good and evil. Social evolution, to him, it was the transition, you will find it in his books, from the archaic and the era of a divided world to the era of world reunification, common labor to the era of the great ring. That's what he called the exchange of information in the universe. And the hands that met. It turns out to be the history of spiritual values, the process of reconstructing consciousness, and not the changes in material basis or the struggle of classes, all this nonsense. Yefremov knew much more and stood above all this. Look, reflections on global problems and the role of science in the modern world, attempts to reconcile technology and spirituality, West and East, despite the appeal to ancient cultures like Greece and India, Yefremov was a thinker who fully belongs to the Russian tradition. That's what some people believe in the former Soviet Union and Russia. But to me, Yefremov's optimism towards human nature, his belief in the prospect of an anthropological revolution, in the boundlessness of human evolutionary possibilities. For Yefremov, pessimism, ideas according to which a person is imperfect and guided by base instincts, were unacceptable. Whoever he was, he believed in humankind, in humanity, and pushed the knowledge. He revealed the ancient knowledge, which is very interesting, the ideas that he talked about and the achievements, as I told you, of ancient civilizations, which maybe someday we will find more. And he believed in the future. And he was a very incredible being, whoever he was. Maybe one day we'll find out more. My advice, if you can, read the book Thais of Athens and other of his books. I wanted to let you know that. Thank you for your attention, and thank you for those who support my research. If you can do it, the links are in the description to this channel. Please tell others about my channel and videos I present and the subjects that I tell you about, and I'll bring you more.